good.
Yeah. Something special, anyway. If you were to stand in line for ice cream, would you want to be in first or last?
Last.
First.
You want to be first, too? No.
Last. Last to see what flavors there are.
Okay. I think most people would like to be in first place. Most people want to be number one. Even in sports, the teams, they want to be number one. When they win a game, they stick their fingers in the air and they go, "We're number one, we're number one." And sometimes their fans even have those big foam fingers. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, I tried to find one. They're really hard to buy. That's all I have to say about that. Anyway, today Brett has some numbers in these envelopes for you. And we're going to pass those out. And you'll each get one. But you cannot open it until we tell you to. Now, wait a minute. Some of you might be one. Some of you might be two. Some of you might be 2,000, okay? Now, it's important as to what your number is, but we cannot have you open them until you all open them together. So, just hold them nice. Are you excited?
No.
No? Okay. You might be excited. Mm-hmm. Get one for Jenny, too. She'll probably need one. And Lynn might want one, too. And if you have enough, give Bonnie one, too. And Danny might need one, too, if he wants.
Danny.
He wants one, too. Never know how many kids there's going to be. Are you ready to see what number you got?
Yeah.
Okay. On, ready, set, go, but that's just, wait. On, ready, set, go, then we're going to open them, okay? Now this is a real thing. Brett's going to say it.
Ready, set, go.
Okay. Jeff, what number are you?
I'm number one.
I'm number one.
You're all?
I'm number one.
You're all number one?
Number one.
You know what? Everybody's number one. Everybody's number one in God's eyes. Each one of us is the most important person to God. In John 3:16, it says, God so loved the world, that means all of us, that he gave us Jesus Christ to be our Savior. Even if you were the only person in the world who ever sinned, God still would have sent Jesus just for you. Because you're number one in God's eyes, all of you are number one, every single one of you. You'll always be number one in God's eyes. And since you're number one in God's eyes, he wants you to think about others before yourself. Think about putting others in front of your needs. God has given you all you will need, and sometimes he gives you extra to share. We can show God's love by letting others be first and by sharing. Don't think less of yourself. Think about yourself less. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, that each one of us is number one in your eyes. Help us to make sure that you're number one in our eyes. Help us to remember to think of others before ourselves. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Your treats are in the...
are going back. Thank you, Brett and Jennifer. As the children are going back, we have a special treat this morning, another special music session. From Lynn. Lynn Blackwall is going to sing If We've Ever Needed You.
Cry, Lord, we pray. Our faces down, our hands all raised. You called us out. turned away, we've turned away. With shipwrecked faith, the idols rise. We do what is right in our own eyes. Our children now will pay the price. We need your light, Lord, shine your light. If we've ever needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, it's now. We are desperate for your hand. We're reaching out. We're reaching out. All our hearts, all our strength, all our minds, we're at your feet. May your kingdom come in our hearts and minds. Lord, revive your church. Revive your church. If we've ever needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, it's now. We are desperate for your hand. We're reaching out. We're reaching.
Thank you, Lynn. Beautiful. Casting crowns. Now Bonnie's going to read to us from Corinthians, 2 Corinthians.
Brothers and sisters, we want to let you know about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia. While they were being tested by many problems, their extra amount of happiness and their extreme poverty resulted in a surplus of rich generosity. I assure you that they gave what they could afford, and even more than they could afford, and they did it voluntarily. They urgently begged us for the privilege of sharing in this service for the saints. They even exceeded our expectations because they gave themselves to the Lord first and to us, consistent with God's will. As a result, we challenge Titus to finish this work of grace with you the way he had started it. So ends the reading of God's holy word.
Bonnie, just love Corinthians, love Paul, as you know. Good morning once again. You know, last week we talked about fear, and we talked about what we can, or how crippling fear can actually be to ourselves. We talked about how it can actually take over our hearts and in a position where it's so big and so great that that fear prevents anything else from coming into our heart. It prevents happiness and joy. We can't be both fearful, totally afraid, and very happy at the same time. So the question remains, what do we do about that fear? How do we turn to God and ask Him to remove that fear from us? And if we do just that, will that take care of it? Are there some other things that we can do to help God, help us get rid of that fear? You know, it doesn't seem to me like it was just 3 years ago, but it was. 3 years ago, in the country of Chile, 33 men were blocked in a mine, a copper mine, 2,000 feet below the surface, 2,000 feet of rock. If you could look out the window here, you can't see 2,000 feet. It's not far enough. You can't see it. That's almost half a mile down in a dark cavern and no way to get out. Actually, when everything collapsed, what happened was the main exit collapsed, but it left another exit open that was normally used for ventilation. The mining company was actually fined 30 days prior to that for not having ladders in the mine so they could reach that exit. So that exit became inaccessible. They couldn't go that way. So here they are locked in this deep, dark cavern with no way out. They started to pray. They said, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this? Some of the men, actually, one guy planned his wedding because he knew he was going to get out somehow, planned his wedding. Others sang songs and tried to chant things that kept him up. And many others crawled into a corner that was dark and stayed away from everybody, remained alone. The leader of the group was able to ration out some food. Each man got 2 teaspoons of tuna a day, 1 little sip of milk, and a bit of peaches. That was all they had to eat that day. Soon it became a worldwide, a global news information. People were everywhere were worried about these miners that were trapped. And so the country of Chile started to try to figure out a way to get to these miners, to save their lives. So they brought in experts from all over the world, including some folks from our country, with NASA. And they came up with a very ingenious way to get them out. The problem is they still had to drill a big hole like that 2,000 feet through solid rock. They still had to do that. So they began drilling. And they designed a 13-foot capsule. But before they did all that, they had a communication hole that they had drilled, and they were able to drop food and necessary things down that communication hole and video cameras. So we got to see what it was like in some of those situations when they were down there in the hole. Many of them prayed for Bibles and crosses and rosaries, and the Pope actually blessed the rosaries that was given to them. For 69 days, almost 70 days, they stayed in that hole trying to get out. But on October 13th, 2010, the men began to climb out of the hole with this capsule, completely surrounding them with this capsule that pulled them out of this darkest, scariest place, pulled them up one at a time, and brought them into daylight. The world celebrated their success. One of the miners, as I mentioned, planned his wedding anniversary. Another of the miners actually decided to travel all the world. In fact, he made a stop one time at, I think it was the Tonight Show that he was on there. He did an Elvis impersonation. And so he took that kind of a show all over the world, and then he went back to Chile. So the world celebrated their success. Did you notice that the men that were trapped in the mines said, we have to get out of here. We are in this dark place. We have to get out of here. And no one stood up and said, I'm going to do it myself. None of them says, you guys go ahead and do something, but I'm going to work on my own escape route. They all said together that we need help from someone else. Someone else is our only option that's going to save us. They all said that. It was unanimous. We need someone to penetrate our darkness. We need someone to come into where we are so that we can step inside and have this capsule surrounding us and have this capsule filling us that is pulling us constantly away from the things that are not of God, constantly pulling us away into the light, just like the miners. One at a time, we can be saved. Why is it so hard for us to do the same? When we try to solve things ourselves, it guarantees nothing but exhaustion. We try to do good, we try to do things for others, we think that's going to position us right with God. But here's the main message this morning. If you hear anything else, here's what you need to hear. Stop it. Stop trying to do things to get favor with God. Stop. You get to the point in your life where you're praying to God for His favors. You're praying to God for His gifts, the things that He has. You're praying for Him to give you those things. But you need to cross. We all are called to cross that threshold and ask for God Himself. Not the favors of God, but God Himself. If we've ever needed You, reach down with Your hand, God. That's what we need, is You. By God's grace, we are saved. So where are these miners now? What's going on in Chile? What are they doing? They had fame. They came out of the hole and there's bright lights everywhere. They were heroes when they came out. The guy that traveled all over the world was a hero. Where are they now? Well, before we get to that, we need to probably cover a few points that will explain where they are. As you know, being a Christian is not necessarily an easy thing to do. It's difficult. Sometimes we think that being a Christian, all we have to do is, okay, I've been saved, I can lean back. In fact, there are some denominations that say, okay, I've been saved, now I can do anything I want. Doesn't matter. Once saved, always saved. Some people believe that. That's fine. But what do we do as Christians? Once we get saved, that's when the work begins. That's when it gets tough. That's when we say, when you stand up and say, I'm a Christian, you're going to be subject to ridicule. Look what's happening in the media. We hear it all the time. All the things that are going on of removing church and state. It truly is an attack on Christianity. I mean, it's an agenda that some people have to go after that. So it's hard. It's difficult. But that's where the work is. In his book, It's Not About Me, Max Lucado talks about the fact that everything that's happened today, we need to blame on Copernicus. It's all his fault. Copernicus and then Leonardo da Vinci. We have to blame them. Because they were the first ones to say that the earth went around the sun and not the other way around. Prior to that, everybody thought that the earth was the center of the universe and everything went around them. They thought it was all about them, all about us. Until it was discovered that that's not true, of course. We go around the sun. We are minor when it comes to the scheme of things. Copernicus was banned and put into solitary confinement for the rest of his life because of what he said. It wasn't for a couple hundred years later before Leonardo came out with the same thing. And he was afraid to mention it. The point is that we need to constantly think and put the creator of the universe, the human son that came to be with us and teach us, And the Holy Spirit that is here now as our companion, put them as number one. How many times when you've ever been asked, what's the most important thing in your life? There are many people that will say family. Family is the most important thing to me. And this can be an issue sometimes, because by putting God first, when you're asked what's the most important thing, is God, family, and then career or church or whatever after that. But God needs to come first in your life. Marriages succeed when the two partners focus on Christ. That focus keeps them together. That focus is the glue of bonding. That's how it happens. By focusing on Christ and putting Him as number one. It's something that we hear and have heard all the time that we grow up. Think about yourself. Thine own self be true. You're number one. Go for it. Position yourself as the one, the leader. Go for it, regardless of the consequences. You're number one. And so we hear that all the time, and we think that. And sometimes we're actually taught that because maybe our low self-esteem says that we need to focus on ourselves and say, okay, I am better than that. I am better than so-and-so. I'll be darned if I'm not just as good as you are. We're always comparing ourselves to someone else, but you compare yourself to Christ and compare yourself to being Christ-like, that helps our living. That gives us strength. That gives us a way to tuck away our fear, because He's number one. He's number one in our life. What we need to focus on, and as we get to this stage where we're not asking for the favors of God or the gifts of God, but we're actually asking for God Himself, all of a sudden His will for us becomes crystal clear. So crystal clear that we can see our purpose in life and have direction on how to do it and how to get there. What a wonderful feeling that is. We've talked about that before. We call that our sweet spot, living in our sweet spot. So what can we do to live a God-centered life? You know, Gandhi himself said, God dare not appear before a hungry man except in the form of bread. God dare not appear before 33 miners half a mile down below the surface of the earth except in the form of a capsule. God meets you where you are. No matter what, He'll meet you there. He meets you right where you are, whatever it takes. Now, a couple more examples. Have you ever heard of Jack Tinker and Partners? Anybody raise your hand if you've heard of Jack Tinker and Partners? No? How about Doyle Dane Birnbach? Anybody? No. How about B.B. D.O. Anybody heard of BBDO? No? How about Foot, Cone, and Belding? Familiar? No, it's not. Well, nobody knows these people. I didn't know them at first, but I do know what they have done. Have you ever heard Plop, Plop, Fizz, Fizz, Oh, What a Relief It Is? Yeah? What product is that? Alka-Seltzer, yeah. The advertising company that put that together was this John Tinker and Partners. Have you ever heard of We Try Harder? We're number two, We Try Harder. Who's that? Well, that didn't come out. Ah, Avis Rent-A-Car. That was put together by Doyle Dane and Birnbach, created this slogan for Avis. Okay, how about this one? Good. Campbell's Soup, yep. That was put together by BBDO in 1935, and they're still using it today. Well, I'm sure you'd never heard of that last one we talked about, Foot, Cone, and Belding, but does this sound familiar at all? When you care enough to send the best. Hallmark cards put together by them also, well, in 1934, and they're still using it today. Okay, here's another one. Snap, crackle, pop. Rice Krispies. Put together, that slogan was put together by J. Walker Thompson. Now, that jingle can be in your head for a long time. The point is, we don't know these people. We know what they have done for their client. Right? Isn't that what God's asking us of? We don't want to worry about people to get to know us. If we reflect God to others, that's our job. That's what we need to do. When they talk to us, help them know God better. Just like these advertising agencies focus on their clients, we need to focus on God. We need to reflect everything that comes at us for the glory of God and keep Him number one. When we do that, and by keeping Him number one, we are able to put these fears and all of the things that I call life killers, regret, guilt, anything that eats at you, we're able to put that away because we know God is first and we know that God does not want us to have those. So where are these miners? What happened to them today? Let me tell you, there were 33 miners who came out of the darkness and made it into the light. All of them today are currently unemployed. 90% of them have post-traumatic stress syndrome. They're under psychiatric care. When you think about that, it's very common that when you are all of a sudden are a hero in the eyes of the world for worldly things, but then you don't work on it, you don't take it further and study and work for the glory of God, you rest on your laurels, things can happen and it doesn't work out. It's a very sad situation. But it's quite common. How many times have you seen movie stars that are on top, and then what happens? They end up on the bottom. Or sports figures that we glorify. They're on top, but soon they're on the bottom. Because they've put number one as either themselves or worldly things that go away. I like to look at it as those lights that shine the brightest burn out the quickest. And when I ran that by Bonnie last night, she came up with something that I thought was terrific. Think of it as these are people with the light shining from the outside onto them. They're heroes. When the light comes from the outside, that light burns out and goes away. But if that light comes from the inside, because of the Holy Spirit and because of God, that never goes away. You keep that no matter what happens in life. It's there. It gives you that joy. It doesn't go away. So what can we do sometimes to put God first? There's a couple things we can do. Just think about these for a little bit. Every day, set aside some quiet time. We need to do that anyway. We're in a pretty busy world. It's hard sometimes to just sit down, take a deep breath, and say, I got to relax. But take some quiet time and look at some devotions, read the Bible, or just sit there quietly and think about God. Whatever you want to do, but you need that quiet time. Some people need 3 minutes. Others need 3 hours. Whatever works for you. Set at least one goal to achieve in your life. And make it a really tough one, like maybe trying to learn a new language. Give yourself something kind of to shoot for. Fall in love with your favorite Bible passage. Find something that's your favorite. In fact, someday we're going to have whoever volunteers for it, someone to stand up and quote or read their favorite Bible passage and then tell us why it's your favorite. Find your purpose. And do the will of God with unlimited enthusiasm. Read a book on Christianity. There's a tons of book out there. C.S. Lewis has got a great one called Mere Christianity. It's fantastic. Read a book on Christianity. And if you have to, find one with pictures. Manage your money in a way that honors God. God is calling us to give a percentage of our income to His work. And let me tell you, we are working. We are doing things in this community. We are helping those that need help. You wouldn't believe the number of times that we've been working and getting it done. So your funds are being put to great use in helping families buy food. Didn't have any with an infant. Another one with a family of 6 children. These are burned out of apartments. We help them with housing. So you're doing good. So a percentage of your income coming to the body of Christ for doing good works is what we need to do. Make people more important in your life than stuff. Offer yourself to others. Make sure that they are in your life. There's a movement going on today. And it's a movement that glorifies God, and it helps us to realize that really God is number one. It constantly reminds us that God is number one. It's called I Am Second. And you can find out all about it at IamSecond.com. When you go there, you will see Bethany Hamilton, the surfer that lost her arm to a shark, give her testimony. You will see Coach Dundy, the coach of the Indianapolis Colts when he won the Super Bowl, talk about his testimony and how he found God and how he keeps God number one. And there are literally hundreds of other people, from drug addicts to prostitutes to high-powered people in government, that have changed their lives because they finally realize that they are second. Check it out, IamSecond.com. As you look at that website and as you think about putting yourself in second place, it's almost an unnatural thing to ask ourselves to do, to put us in second place, because we've always focused on being number one. But you can do it by whatever means. Realize that your life centers around Christ and nobody centers around you. Amen.